Welcome to Misumi's new 19-minute webinar series. For those of you here that are new to Misumi, Misumi is a global supplier of configurable components. You may ask, why configurable? What is it? Configurable components solve the designer's dilemma. A designer has two choices for components, standard or custom. Standard components have limited selection and often force designers to compromise their designs. These many pluses, such as CAD, static part numbers, fast delivery, often seem inexpensive and convenient. The other choice is custom. Custom components have many drawbacks. Designers have to make the solid models themselves in all the manufacturing drawings. Purchasers too can attest to the long wait for quotes, the expensive setup charges for short runs, and the long lead times. We are forced to use custom components though, because of the flexibility. Misumi offers configurable, which is the best of both, easy and flexible. Configurable components are easy to design with and purchase. Online, select the product geometry desired, the material and surface finish, input the size for each configurable dimension within the range and increment shown. You'll get a smart part number, instant price and days to ship, and the CAD model. All of this configurability is available with our over 1 million components, available at MisumiUSA.com. Now, I'll turn it over to our Misumi engineer.
Hello, my name is Chuck Leonard. I'm one of the senior application engineers with the Motion Systems Group at Misumi USA. Today I'd like to introduce you to our RS Manager software package. This is the software that is used to program our RS series robots and our RSH series robots. First thing we're going to do is we're going to make a connection to the robot using the RS Manager software. We go up and we click on New Connection. We click on that, it's going to open up a window that presents our COM ports. Now we're going to go down and select the COM port that our robot's on, and ours is on robot COM port number 8. As soon as I click on it, it's going to start searching for controllers. Once it finds the controllers, it'll start obtaining the data from it and downloading it from the controller. Once we've downloaded all the data and the parameters, it'll open up the main menu. Now you look at the top window of this menu, we've got a standard Windows menu, which gives us our main menu panel. And then directly below that, we've got our toolbar. Now in our toolbar, we've got places here for making new connections, opening and saving files. We can print our programs. We can preview the print. We can also edit, copy, and paste parts of the program. Directly below that, we've got our toolbar, which provides us our different controller tools where we can read and write our software to the controller. And we can open up different diagnostic windows in our operator panel. Next window we have over here, this is our controller tree. This is where all the parameters for the robot are located. Below that, we have our editing window. This is where we edit the program file. Above this, we have our control panel that has all of our start, stop, and our jogging buttons, so we can jog back and forth. To the left over there, we have our status window. Let's go up here to our parameter tree and look at some of our parameters. Now, under Run Parameters, click on this. These are all the different parameters set up for running and setting positions in the robot as far as some of the parameters inside the system. Now, if you go up here, and I want to show you a nice feature on this. If we click on one of these parameters, you'll get a window up above here that shows you what the parameter does and what the allowable ranges are for that parameter. This keeps you from having to go back and forth to the manual to find out what the different parameters do. Now we'll take a look at the I/O parameters on the robot. This gives you the capabilities here. This is where you set up one of the four user programmable outputs that are available. You have 9 different modes that you can select in these. You go down and click which mode that you want for that particular output to work. So it gives you the option of one of the 9 for all 4 of them. Next thing we want to look at is our option parameter. Now the option parameter is where you turn on and off the different options for the robot. This current option here is enable the I/O port. So if you're not using it, you can disable it. If you are using it, you want to have it enabled so that you have communication through that port. Now let's take a look at the servo parameters. The servo parameters got 2 items that I really want to show you that are real important. We have payload 1 and payload 2. What this does is gives you the ability to set what the maximum payloads are for the robot, and because this sets the acceleration rate and controls high-end speed of the robot. So we go in and we click on this, and it optimizes the overall performance of the robot. I'm going to go back and click on the point file here. Now in the point file, what this gives us, opens the editing window up. Now in this edit window, we have a couple of things that we can do. We can start program, we can set up the different run modes, but before we do, I want to set up the run mode for the robot. We're going to go down here and we're going to change the run mode, and I'm going to set this run mode to debug. So go down here and click on debug. And click on it, and then now I'm going to click OK. Now the different run modes for the robot, you've got three modes. In the normal mode, this permits operation from both the I.O. control through the digital I.O. and communications from the PC, the handy terminal, or your PLC. In the monitor mode, this permits full function of I.O. and control, but communication from the PC or the handy terminal or the serial input port is not allowed. You cannot do any data editing in this mode. The debug mode gives you communication from the PC or the HMI through the serial port, but does not allow any I.O. control through the I.O. port. So let's go back to our program window and let's take a look at a couple of things we can do. I want to set up a couple of different run types. We have two different types of run modes that we can be. We can make incremental or we can make absolute moves. If you go down through here, you click on run, it shows all the different moves that are available. Now, on these different moves, you have the standard moves on an absolute or an incremental move. What we do is we accelerate from a zero speed, we come up to speed, and then we deaccelerate as we approach our position. Now, depending on the length of the move, you may not achieve full speed, and it may be more of a triangular move. But this is a standard for absolute or incremental. Now, a merge move is similar in that you can have multiple moves together. And what we're doing is we're combining moves. We can change speed without coming to complete stop. Now, this is very useful if you want to change acceleration rates as you're making a move, or if you want to turn outputs on and off during the move. The next move that we have is a push move. Now the push move gives you the capability of moving a standard move. You accelerate up to speed, but as you are approaching something, you can control the amount of force that you're applying at the end of the move. This gives you the capability of pushing against an object or compressing an object or inserting parts into an object. The push rate's adjustable by move. Final move that we have in here is a push with a deacceleration. This is kind of a combination between a merge and a push move. It gives you the capabilities of coming up to speed and then deaccelerating as you're approaching your part so that you don't have to bang against it, and then apply a slower speed to apply the force to push the part into position. This can be very useful for part assembly. So let's go on back to our screen here, and we're going to start programming a couple of different points. We'll go back up here. We're going to click on our absolute move. Now you'll notice as soon as the absolute move was clicked on, it filled in all the default values for the robot. Now let's look at each of these different columns that we have in here for these default values. Now position, this is position anywhere from zero to the maximum length of the robot. Next column over is going to be the speed. We can set that from 100% to zero. Then we have our acceleration and deacceleration rates. Now these are going to be set to their maximum based on the parameter set in the servo parameters. Now we have our push command. This is where we adjust the percentage of force based on our push moves. And this depends on different for each type of robot. Then we have our zone plus and our zone minus. Now this is where we can control when the outputs come on and off. You can use one of those four user selectable outputs. The same thing here for the near width. This can be set up into one of our four user selectable outputs. Now this is our jump position. The jump position is very important. It tells what point do you execute next after you've executed the point. Then we have a flag bit. The flag bit is useful because you can use this for setting up which payload parameter you want to use and also how you want the robot to act when it's sitting still. The final column that we have here is a timer. What this is a millisecond timer that we can set up to allow us a time delay between moves anywhere from 0 to 3 milliseconds. I'm going to go back over here and I'm going to add a few more moves in. Now you'll notice here, put one of these moves in, that everything is highlighted. This means that the program that's on the screen is different than the one that's in the controller. So if we want to save this down to the controller, we go up and we write it to the controller. You'll get a warning here that you're about to write software to the controller. You click on OK. It writes the data down to the controller. And as soon as the data has been written, you get an OK back, and you'll notice that the program line is no longer highlighted. So the information that's on the screen matches what's in the controller. Now I'm going to go in here and I'm going to add a couple of different moves. Now these different moves here, we're going to have, the first move I'm going to do is an absolute move. We'll do this for 150 millimeters and we're going to run it at full speed. Next move we'll do here, let's do another absolute. But I think I'll do this one for 50 millimeters and we'll run this one at 50% speed. So we'll go ahead and we'll change the speed here. Again, you'll note that everything is highlighted because it's different than from what's in the controller. We're not going to mess with the acceleration rate. We'll leave that as is. Now, I'm going to add a couple of incremental moves here. I'm going to click on incremental. We'll go down here and we'll click on the incremental. Now, incremental moves are moves from your current position. So I'm going to make this a 25 millimeter positive move, which will move us 25 millimeters further away from the motor. And then I'll make my next move will be a 25 millimeter negative move. What this will do is move us 25 millimeters back to where we started from. I get all these moves in. I'm going to add one more absolute move here at the end, and I'm going to set this one to zero. We've set all our moves in here. Now, one thing we want to go back is we want to know what order that we're going to execute these moves in. So we go over here to the jump column, and I want these to execute in order that they are. So we will go from position one to position two. So I'll go ahead and put a two here, and two to three to four to five, and 5 to 6. Now on this last one, if I leave this at zero, the robot will stop executing the program at this point. But I'm going to make it a continuous loop so it just continuously operates, and we're going to jump back to position number one. We're not going to add any time delays, so now our program is ready to write to the controller. So we click on write to our controller. All the data is written back. You'll notice our highlights went away. All this information now matches what's in the controller. Now, I want to run this program. So what I need to do now is I open the operator panel, I need to enable the servo, and I need to home the robot so that we know the position it's at. You should hear a slight humming noise out of the robot, and the robot will start homing. And you'll notice that once it's homed, down here in our status window, we've turned on our servo and our origin search light has come on indicators. I'm going to move this window out of our way so we can see the rest of the screen here. Now, we're ready to run our program. Before we can run the program, we have to select the position we want it to start at. So I'm going to start at position number one. I go up from there and I click on start, and our robot starts executing the program. Now, if you see in the run point indicator up here, it tells us which position is actually being executed at what time. And then we can go down here and I can turn on our point monitor, and it'll actually show you on the program as it executes each of the points. Now, down in the lower left-hand corner, you'll see we have our position indicator. That position indicator is showing the current position of the robot and what point's actually being executed at the time. I'm going to turn off this run monitor, and we'll go up here and we'll stop the robot from running. So we've stopped our operation. Click on this. I get a lot of people that give me questions now. How do I teach points on the fly? There's several ways you can teach points with the robot. You can teach it through the handy terminal or through the RS manager, or you can teach it through the PLC using the RS-232 port or the CC-Link or DeviceNet ports, or you can also teach it through the digital I.O. ports. And I'm going to show you how to teach it with the RS manager. Now with RS manager, now you notice here on that position number 6, I left that at 0. We're going to teach this point. So I'm going to click on that point, and I'm going to go up and I'm going to jog my robot back and forth using my jog plus and minus until I got the robot to the position I want. Now you hold the jog button, the robot continuously moves. Now if I want to make small little bitty moves, I go up here and I click on the inching. Now the inching, you can change that how far that robot's going to move by changing that inching width. So each time I've got this set now for 1 millimeter, each time I set the move, it'll go 1 millimeter. Once I've got in position, I go over and I hit teach, and it's going to give me a warning that I'm going to teach this position. And you'll notice that it's come up highlighted because that's different than what's in our controller. So now I write that to my controller, and the data writing's been complete. Now this is the new location position for that that particular point. Now let's take and see how this program runs. We go up, we started at position one, and we start running the program. And if you'll watch that position indicator down there, you'll notice that the last point execute is 119.44 millimeters. So we're going to stop the monitor. Now I've opened up a window here that's going to show you some of the diagnostic tools here. This is our I/O monitor. It's showing the status of each of the I/O ports. Now we don't have anything on the input side, so we don't have anything showing there. Now I'm going to open up our information monitor. Now the information monitor shows the current status bits for all the robots. Some of these come out on the I/O, but it also shows internal registers. Now these registers can be downloaded through the RS-232 port, through the DeviceNet port, or the CC-Link port. A lot of people like to know what the current position of the encoder feedback information. This is where you can get this information from and load it into your PLC. I'm going to close this port down. And I'm going to open up the alarm port. Now the alarm port, this shows a record of any alarms that may have occurred on the robot in its history. I'm going to close this down. Say I want to save a program. Now you can go up here and you can save the current program that's in the controller. So we're going to save this and we're going to save it as controller number 2. So click on it, save on number 2, and click save. It'll tell you, warn you if the program file's already there. You click save and it's okay. It's downloaded and it's saved it on your laptop or in your PC. This is really useful if you want to clone or reload the software after you've got a new robot or if you've done some maintenance on the robot. So we can go in here and let's load up a program that I've previously written. I'm going to go down here and I'm going to load controller number 10. So I'm going to load this program up. Now this program's got some nice things, a little different. It shows 2 recipes. So we have 2 programs in the same program. You can store as many programs as you want up to the 255 positions. So I'm going to load this program. Now I want to save it. So we're going to tell it which robot we're going to save it to. So it's warning me that the robot's online. It's already got another motion program, am I sure? So we're going to transfer the data now down to the current controller. So now we're rewriting the program that's in the current robot. It'll confirm back that we've got a good write and all the information and data transfer is complete. It'll ask you to restart the robot from that point. Now you'll notice we don't have any control buttons on this screen because we opened up a second window when we opened up this new program. So I'm going to go over here and I'm going to close my operator panel and I'm going to close this window down and open back up to our main window. And you'll see our control panel is back. And we now have our new program loaded into our software. Now we have multiple recipes, so I'm gonna go start on my second program here. The nice thing about it now is with these multiple recipes, I can run this robot without having to stop and reprogram it, just by changing what position I actually start the robot in. And this can be done through your PLC, through the digital I/O port, or through the data registers. So we'll run here and you'll see our little programs running back and forth, and our robot's moving now. We offer a complete set of these manuals for this robot, free of charge. You can download these, or you can send an email to motionsystems@misumiusa, put RS Manager Manual Set in the title, and I'll be happy to send you a copy. I want to thank you for joining us today.
Thank you, and we hope you enjoyed today's webinar. All of Misumi's configurable components and 1 million products are available at www.misumiusa.com. If you are new to Misumi, register for access to CAD downloads, online formal quotes and orders, and manage all of your account histories. For first-time companies purchasing, you can receive 30% off. Full support is also available. Technical help at engineering@misumiusa.com, customer service at inquire, and your local account manager at sales. Facebook now has our 19-minute video series available to view at your leisure. Connect with us to join the conversation and see exclusive content. Thank you again.